It's Kat, and I'm back today with another decoding. This one is on the movie called The Road. This movie is so sad, and yet, at the same time, it fills me with hope. What the controllers want least of all is our people to be filled with hope. Because hope breeds courage, and courage breeds passion. This passion is what will save our people. The Jesus of the Bible teaches us to stifle our passions, but that is just not so. As per the Ora Linda book, it says, although they knew that Jesus had taught that men should regulate and control their passions, they taught that men should stifle their passions, and that the perfection of humanity consisted in being as unfeeling as the cold stones. In William Gailey Simpson's book, Which Way, Western Man?, Simpson also sees the truth about the Bible being a book to manipulate us into not following our passions, into making us one of the herd, that is, meek and mild, and does what he is told. This is a big part of what got us into this mess. The Ora Linda book tells us not to be meek and mild. It states, if we should be ill-treated, whether distant or near, we must immediately attack them. For though we desire to be at peace, we must not let our neighbors underrate us or think that we are afraid. And since I so love this story, The Road, I wanted to take a look at its author to see what kind of man he is. Is he one to lead our people astray, or is he truly trying to help? This is the photo of the author, Cormac McCarthy, when he was young and just starting out as a writer. Although it appears he is doing the hidden hand here and looking to the left, left-hand path, I do believe The Road rings true. Many of his other books are filled with raw violence and blood. Well, this one has it too, but there is much more to this story. I believe he is the best writer alive today, bar none, even if he might be compromised. McCarthy never wanted to work and said his number one priority was that, finding a way so he didn't have to work. So he picked a profession in which he wouldn't have to be in this system of oppression, in the 9-to-5 grind. I admire him greatly for that. He was so poor at one time, he got kicked out of a $40 a month hotel in New Orleans. I'd like to think some of that same Fryan spirit, to be free, runs in me, although it has taken me longer to realize it for what it is. Was he just young and naive? The two always go hand in hand. Did he know what the symbolism meant? A friend told me once, it's like walking in the woods. You are enjoying yourself, checking out the trees, the nature, the beauty. But before long, though, you realize you aren't on that path anymore, and you can't find your way back out. He doesn't do but a rare interview, doesn't like talking about his writing, and hangs out with scientists instead of fellow authors. Why? Is his conscience getting the best of him? And if you are a follower of my work, you will know I am always interested in the meaning behind words, and especially names. Well, Cormac's first name is very interesting. Cor means wheel, which is the Yule. We come into this mortal coil on Weralda's carrier wheel when we are born and leave when we die. This Yule gives us language, numbers, and time. The Yule is life. And Mac is used to denote sun, in both Irish and Scottish names. So Cormac means son of the Yule, Worlda's most sacred symbol, making it a very good Fryan name. Now his last name, McCarthy, seems to have a good meaning as well. Mick or Mac is used for clan or son of, and Carthy means loving. So the name McCarthy means loving son. So Cormac McCarthy, or loving son of the Yule, is a man who didn't stifle his passions, but was it for a price? Remember, he didn't make this movie. It was rewritten as a screenplay, and any images in the movie aren't necessarily in there because of him. McCarthy once said, "Look, a novel's a novel and a film's a film, and they're very different." He dedicated this story to his son of the Yule, John. Our story starts with the man dreaming of his former life, before the event that changed everything. In the summer, the height of Worlda's glory, when the days are at their longest, with the warm rays of the sun shining down on the world, filling it with splendid light and vibrant color. The man was happy in this world, at peace. He had what was needed to make a man content. Still dreaming, he recollects the moment that everything changed. A bright light outside their nighttime window. Booms, crying and screaming. Years later, he is a shell of the man he was then. Now the world was violently ripped from the good of Worlda's world. Here, in man's world, the world of Lucifer, there is only darkness and cold. The color contrast is so striking. Worlda's world is all that is good made by day, and all that is evil made by night. When I say Lucifer's world, I don't believe there is an entity that is powerful and in opposition to God. I mean Lucifer, as in the evil in men, in particular men, shaping the world into this hell. Color is good. The black and white of night is bad. Masons use the black and white checkerboard. They are all about the night. Here, with the star of Lucifer in the center, they use world as color against us, turning the rainbow into LGBTQ. Notice the communist fist of the controllers, and with a sort of halo illuminating around it. The man narrates, "It was a long sheer of bright light, and then a series of concussions." This gives us an idea of what the event is, but not quite. In their present time, the boy feels the rumble below, and the man says not to worry, they're just earth tremors. Who created this world of death and destruction, of eternal gray and misery? Not Worlda. It is the doings of the Magi, the Luciferians. The road, a journey of a father and son. El Camino, which means the road in Spanish, is also a journey of a father and son. Although Walt and Jesse's journey is different from the man and the boy, in a way, it too is a tale of survival. With Walt dying, just like the man dies, and Jesse surviving and having to start a new life, just like the boy. Jesse looks like an older version of the boy. Notice, though, they have Jesse doing the one eye, the left eye, the moon eye, the eye of Lucifer. He did as thou will and followed the left-hand path, making drugs to make money. All is dead, a bleak, lifeless world. Reading chronicles of pre-Celtic Europe, where Raubenheimer is talking about what happened after the Great Flood, when Atlantis sunk, we see it is exactly what is going on here. We read, human endeavors were reduced to the most basic needs for survival. In the void left by the collapse of institutionalized security and military structures, anarchy reigned. Looting, pillaging, murder, rape, and every conceivable atrocity became a way of life. Strength lay in numbers. Rulers, leaders, the wealthy, the intelligentsia, and academics became targets of anger and hate. It was survival of the strongest. The only difference is what happened in the Orlena book happened in real life, and this could happen again. The man is driven by a purpose. He must go on, taking care of the boy. They walk through a tunnel. At the entrance is a billboard with the original advertisement long gone. In its place, someone spray painted a portion of Jeremiah 19:6 that reads, "Behold, the valley of slaughter." It is from the prophecy of the broken jar, which reads, "They have built high places to Baal, on which to burn their children in the fire as offerings to Baal, something I never commanded or mentioned, nor did it ever enter my mind. So behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, when this place will no longer be called Topheth or the Valley of Ben Hinnom, but the Valley of Slaughter. And in this place I will ruin the plans of Judah and Jerusalem. I will make them fall by the sword before their enemies, by the hands of those who seek their lives. And I will give their carcasses as food to the birds of the air and of the beasts of the earth." Well, it is the Valley of Slaughter, with bones strewn on the floor, carcasses to birds long gone, bones lying alongside cast pearls and money, no longer the important things. Death and destruction, the great equalizer of the rich and the poor. Bill Gates would have no more power than the beggar man on the street. Things still to be thankful for. They camp for the night and the man reads to the boy. They wake to a fire in the near distance. The world burns. Fire is a symbol for Fryan, the free people, the people the man and the boy belong to. In this world, guns and ammunition are what's of value. They are down to two precious shells. The man falls asleep again and reflects back on the last days with his wife. The color is leaving their world. Outside, it is just gray. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. And in all this death and destruction, life still appears. She gives birth to the boy. The man is startled awake by the sound of a truck backfiring and the shouts of men, men with guns. Notice the truck only has one light working. It's doing the one eye, showing the moon eye, the left eye, the eye of Lucifer, letting us know what kind of people these are. In this post-apocalyptic world, ragtag good people and ragtag bad people. Bad people eat people. Good people don't. That's the difference. Remember who ate people in the Orlena book? Lyda ate people. From the Orlena book, Ion crossed over to Lyda's land. There, the black people wanted to catch them and eat them. But today, the Magi, a mixed race of Lyda, Finda, and Fryan, eat people too. They try to trick us into thinking eating human flesh is okay. with people promoting it, like Marina Abramovich and her, or is it his, spirit cooking. Notice he life and on the left shoulder. Here's Lady Gaga having a taste with Marina inspecting the body. And Katy Perry in her video where she is the meal. White people seem to be the main course. Lida seated for the meal. And promoting cannibalism in a film called Alive, with the story of the Uruguayan rugby team that had to eat people to stay alive. Did they? And again in the movie called The Bad Batch, in which, to live, they had to eat people. They make the main characters attractive, endearing, so we empathize with them, getting us to believe that eating people ain't so bad. That boy looks hungry. Why don't you come to the truck? Get something to eat. You don't need to be such a hard ass. He tries to pretend he still has humanity left in him, but there is none. He is a cannibal and can't hide the fact he desires the boy for food. The man protects the boy, shooting the cannibal in the head, killing him instantly. The boy is in shock. He sees with his right. The boy follows the right-hand path. He has God's laws written in his heart. When the coast is clear, they go back to the road to pick up their belongings. They notice the cannibal's head lying under a car. There is no honor among thieves. They had eaten their friend. That man back there. There's not many good guys left, that's all. You have to watch out for the bad guys. Keep carrying the fire. What fire? The fire inside you. Are we still the good guys? Of course we are. And we always will be? Always will be. An American flag draped at the front of this building. Remnants of a symbol that once meant something, not anymore. And a treat for the boy. The man dislodged it from a vending machine lying in a corner. It was an iconic drink from our world. And so they keep traveling down the road, towards the coast, going south, hoping the world will be warmer there. They hop in a deserted truck stuck on a bridge to rest for the night. The man once again dreams of that long ago time, of his wife teaching him how to play a certain song on the piano. Shocking colors. So bright. He then thinks back to when she finally left. She couldn't take the world they were in anymore, knowing the former world would never return to them. Colors dimming, going out like a candlelight. She was gone, and the coldness of it was her final gift. At first, I thought, what a bitch. How can she do that to her husband, to her son? But I see what she did now. Her being cold in the end made them a little mad at her, and so a little less sad. She wanted to save them from the pain. On suicide in the Orlando book, the embittered Friso had his two children commit suicide to save their souls. So suicide is not bad. The boy woke and said he wanted to be with his mom. The man understood that meant he wanted to die. He told the boy to let go of the things connecting him to her, and so he had to do the same. He took out his wallet, looked one last time at her photo, and tossed it over the edge of the bridge. He took off his ring and pushed it to the precipice, leaving it forever. They continued down the road until they came to a waterfall. Look, Papa, a rainbow, says the boy. The rainbow is said in the Bible to be a covenant between God and man, that God will never wipe the world out with water again. But it did happen again. After Noah's flood, the 2193 BC event, it also happened in 305 BC, and it will happen again. From the Orlinda book we read, "The Magi prided himself on his cunning, but the earth made him know that she would not tolerate any Magi or idol on the holy bosom that had borne Fryan. As a wild horse tosses his mane after he has thrown the rider, so Urtha shook her forests and her mountains. Rivers spread over the fields. The sea raged. Mountains spouted fire to the clouds, and what they vomited forth, the clouds flung upon the earth." What the rainbow does show us, though, is that there is still color in the world, and color symbolizes the good. But with good, it always seems some bad must follow. They come upon a mansion on the road. They are so hungry now that the man feels they must check it out for food. They enter through an open window, and the first thing they notice is a pile of shoes on the living room floor. Do they want you to think of the pile of shoes at Dachau, at Auschwitz, from the people dying of typhus? We will die from malnutrition. In all times of misery, this has happened. All disasters do bring disease and pestilence. Death by starvation, death by disaster. But to me, these shoes represent a symbol of the one shoe, two shoe, or no shoe crew. The same ones putting on these staged events in the world today. All the world's a stage. These shoe clips are all courtesy of my friend, Scotland Sean. This one is from the Asian soccer team that got trapped underground in caves 33 feet high. Remember, 33 is code for Mason, and Masons are Magi. Notice the Nike swoosh, both for the ring of Saturn, which symbolizes the Saturn death cult, and Nike being the goddess of victory. Those pesky Magi casting their spells. 12 players and their manager, trapped underground, representing the 12 apostles and Christ. This one is from the Brussels airport attack. See, she has one shoe on and one shoe off. From the London Bridge attack, shoes neatly placed by the victim. Also from the London Bridge attack, with the shoe neatly placed next to the foot, one shoe on, one shoe off. Here we have another London Bridge attack victim with the barefoot clean feet sticking up and together. See that? Awkwardly? Strangely? We'll show some more later. What they see is almost beyond comprehension. Fellow human beings kept alive with body parts removed. They understand this is because the keepers of this mansion are using them for food. The hunters are cannibals. These poor souls have been caught as prey. The man and the boy run upstairs and are about to run out of the mansion when the boy spots the hunters returning. They run upstairs to hide in the bathroom. The man thinks this is it and prepares himself to shoot the boy to protect him, because there are fates worse than death. But by God's mercy, it doesn't come to that. The trapped humans bang on the cellar door, trying to escape, and it keeps the hunters distracted, dealing with them. The man and boy escape. We would never eat anyone, would we? No, of course not. No matter how hungry we were, even if we were starving, we're starving now. 'Cause we're the good guys. And we carry the fire. Yes. The good people carry the fire. The man and his boy carry it. The fire is the laws that were all to put in Fryan's hearts. From the Orlinda book, this is their earliest history. When the last came into existence, Fryan, were all to breathe his breath upon her in order that men might be bound to him. Fire is an anagram of Freya, just as free is derived from fire and Freya. Fire and free are synonymous with the Fryans, or white race. Again, they show the American flag, letting us know this story is playing out in the U.S., although it can happen anywhere in the world. The man arrives at his childhood home, but the boy is uncomfortable watching his father reminisce, so he sits on the front porch, coloring and waiting. Coloring, right? He has the color. Colors are good. Colors are God. The boy notices movement in a window across the street and gets up and goes to see what it is. He spots a boy, like him, just a few feet away. But his father, who didn't see the other boy, catches up to the boy before he runs off. The boy is utterly devastated. He doesn't believe the boy that he actually saw another child and thinks he's imagining it. They continue traveling down the road and come to a spot that looks like New York with the twin towers in the background, twin boats in the foreground to enforce this thought. If meteors did hit, it would cause tidal waves, making the boats come to shore and land on this freeway. We know from the Orlinda book that the 2193 BC disaster was a combination of meteors and tidal waves. So this could very much be the case of this disaster, although it does feel man-made. Or the world got so bad that we're all to thought, hey, it's time for a reset. The boy spies a house way off the road and they decide to check it out. It brings them just what they needed in the nick of time, food. The prepper bunker is not in the original book, but added in the movie. Notice nothing was touched in there. So no matter how much prepping one does, they need to survive the initial blast and chaotic period. Maybe they were far from home at the time and couldn't get back. But it is a good idea to prep. We can see from the movie the most important things are food, guns, warm clothes, and shoes. Networking with like-kind people is also a good idea. It seems stragglers get picked off by the bad guys. Notice how today the ones in control are this unified group of bad people. They have all the money in the world. But they could be away from their bunkers too. They could be away from their guns. Waralda is good and will make sure his laws survive on his creation, this world. And there are moments of joy in the sad world. A meal between a father and son. When the man sleeps, he dreams more and more of good things. This is a bad sign. It means his time is short. For this world. Vivid green, red, golden hair and skin. Beauty gone from this world. It's almost like a challenge to humanity. How far can a person go? He is a walking skeleton. Back in the fallout shelter, they hear noises above. What sounds like a dog? This scares the man. He is worried about bad people, and so they hit the road again. The only character named in the story is the old man they come across on the road, named Eli. Eli means ascension, moving to a higher level, closer to heaven, a wise man. I knew this was coming, this or something like it. There were warnings. Some people thought it was a con. I always believed in it. Did you try to get ready for it? What would you do? Even if you knew what to do, you wouldn't know what to do. Notice the Masonic pyramid behind them, letting us know the ones behind it. In Christianity, you have the Judeo-Christians who preach the rapture. They say that good people will go at the end times, will get raptured, leaving only the bad here on earth. Then you have other branches of Christianity which teach that there is a sort of rapture, but it's the bad people who go. From the Bible it says in Matthew 13:30 that the wheat are safe in the barn, while the tares get burned in the fire. The truth is, though, that good and bad people go, and good and bad people stay. Our problem will not go away with Armageddon. The bad will also inherit the earth. There is no magical rapture. Magical rapture is made up by the Magi, which is the ancient name of the ones in control today. Magic is from Magi. So there are wheat and tares, though. That part is correct. Wheat are white, and tares are the followers of the Dog Star, the ones in control today. Dog Star is an anagram for Tares God. But the Bible has it wrong because it's not a book for the wheat people. Wheat people are Aryan from Europe, not Judean from the Middle East. That's why I feel so strongly about the Orlinda book. It's a true history of the wheat. So again, Eli said that he knew this was coming, this or something like it. There were warnings. Some people thought it was a con. I always believed in it. You reading this article or listening to this video know it's coming too. But what to do? What to do? The band Tool knows. It's in their song called Learn to Swim. Some of the lyrics go, some say a comet will fall from the sky, followed by meteor showers and tidal waves, followed by fault lines that cannot sit still, followed by millions of dumbfounded dipshits. And some say the end is near. Some say we'll see Armageddon soon. I certainly hope we will. I sure could use a vacation from this stupid shit, silly shit, stupid shit. Do you ever wish you would die? No. No, it's foolish to ask for luxuries in times like these. Eli sees with his right eye. He is a good man. They leave the old man the next morning and head out on the road once again. After a little while, they come across an area with small cabins. And then they notice a bad sign. Golgotha, the place of skulls. These look like baby skulls. The skulls of the innocent. This is a place where the bad people are. The skull and bones people. They run away from this place. They find a church to stay in for the night. The man coughs up blood. He is slowly dying. The boy wakes up and calls out to his papa. I had a really bad dream, papa. If you dream of bad things, it shows you're still fighting. You're still alive. It's when you start to dream about good things, you should start to worry. The man opens up their ragtag map to see where they are at. They are closer to the ocean than the boy thought. But when they get there, it is disheartening. It is not the blue that the man remembered. It is as gray as the land. But they sit there for a while, the father and son, and contemplate the world. What is on the other side? The boy asks. Maybe a father and son sitting on the beach just like you and I, the man says. His survival instinct, always on, tells him to go to the ship and see what he can forage. The boy got sick in the night and so doesn't even notice when the thief approaches, robbing them of all their belongings. When the man swims back, he sees what has happened. He quickly picks up the boy and races after the thief. It is not long before they catch up with him. The thief is missing his thumbs. He is possibly an outcast of some kind. But maybe it's because he wouldn't partake in cannibalism. The thief doesn't kill and eat the boy. Cormac likes to use Bible verses in his story, and so if we look there, we might have a clue. In Judges 1:6, we read, "But Adonibezek fled, and they pursued after him, and caught him, and cut off his thumbs and his great toes." The cutting off of his thumbs would prevent him from ever again drawing a bow or wielding a sword. Romans, who desired to escape conscription, cut off their thumbs. So it is possible he cut off his own thumbs. The man makes the thief strip down naked, putting all his clothes into their cart, and then they leave. The boy is upset about this. "I'm scared, do you understand? I have to worry about everything." Under his breath, "You're not the one that has to worry about everything." "What did you say?" "Yes, I am. I am the one. Okay?" "Okay." Realizing the truth, "Come with me." He saw a bug alive, and the boy heard a dog when he was on his father's porch. So there is hope that the animal kingdom has survivors as well. This all reminds me of those previous worldwide catastrophes. These are resets for humanity, for Weralda's world. We need one of these to reset, to start anew. Notice the shoes dangling from the cart, the shoe crew symbol. And this guy is supposed to be a hero from the London Bridge attack. Notice the Masonic handshake with a thumb placed on top. And barefoot, no shoes once again. And here, the one shoe from the Barcelona attack. The shoe crew are plenty busy. The man is too weak now to go on. They stop the cart, and a little further down, the man collapses in the sand. He dreams of a happy time with his beloved. He will be with her again very soon. The boy senses this, that he has to prepare now for his journey alone. He does what he can for his father, nursing him, comforting him. He has to be the man now. Grave men near death who see with blinding sight, blind eyes could blaze like meteors and be gay. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. And you, my father, there on the sad height, curse, bless me now with your fierce tears, I pray. Do not go gentle into that good night. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. When almost all hope is lost, the boy alone in the world sees someone approaching. A man carrying a weapon with many rounds of ammunition across his chest. The boy knows if he wanted to kill him, it would have been done. So he has hope. Maybe this is one of the good guys. The veteran's thumbs are cut, just like the thief's. Why? Was he a prisoner and escaped? He has survival skills. The thief had to have some, or at least some extreme luck. But he doesn't seem too survival savvy when trying to flee with the man and the boy's things. The veteran seems savvy. He tells the boy that they have been following him and his papa, that they notice his papa has passed. He asks the boy if he would like to go with them. "So you don't eat people?" "No, we don't eat people." "And you're carrying the fire?" "Am I what?" "Carrying the fire. You're kind of weirded out, aren't you, kid?" "Well, are you?" "Yeah, I'm carrying the fire." The boy said he will go with him, but first he has to say goodbye to his papa. "I'll talk to you every day, and I won't forget, no matter what." He was one of the good guys. The veteran's wife approaches the boy. She is glad he is safe. They have a boy and a girl. Humanity will continue. The same boy he saw when sitting on his father's porch. There's even a dog, the smartest dog, a border collie. The Fryans talked about a reset, how they were picked off when they weren't banded together, how they had to band together to overcome the hordes. From the Orlinda book. 3 years the Ur suffered, but when it improved, the forest could be seen. Many countries were submerged. Others had risen out of the sea, and in Twiskland, half of the forests were destroyed. Bands of Finda's people came and settled in the empty spaces. Our dispersed people were exterminated or became their hirelings. Then watchfulness was doubly impressed upon us, and time taught us that unity is our best fortress. They carry the fire. The Freya is in their hearts. Worlda will not forsake us.
I'm so glad to see you. We were following you, did you know that? We saw you with your papa. You're so lucky. We're so worried about you. And now we don't have to worry about them. How's that sound? Is that okay?